The Apostle Peter saw a vivid vision of Jesus Christ returning to earth. This vision gave Peter unbreakable hope for the rest of his life. Learn how to build living hope next on The Key of David with Gerald Flurry.
Greetings, everyone. The Apostle Peter wrote two epistles, and he knew that his own death was imminent at that very time, and he was going to be martyred. Jesus Christ had told him so, and he was prepared for that terrible time. You could add to that all of the other persecution that was going on, severe persecution. He still, in spite of all that, wrote the most hope-filled book in the Bible, if not the entire Bible, at least all the epistles in the Bible. It's just filled with hope, an awesome hope in God. How does that all happen? Why? What did Peter see that made his life so full of hope when anybody, apart from God anyhow, would never be able to think that way under those conditions? These men had been right there with Jesus Christ, and Christ expected more of them than he does most of us. But we're living in a hopeless world, and we need hope. And it's getting worse and worse. Wherever you look, it is getting worse. And we need to be aware of that and understand that. This is not a fantasy we're talking about. It is something very real, but only a few people in this world understand it. Only a few. Notice 1 Peter 1 and verse 3. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again into a lively hope, or the Revised Standard Version says, a living hope. A living hope. That's the title of my booklet on Peter's epistles. By the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, it concludes. So, a hope that lives. Now, you can look at the commentaries, and they don't really understand what this is talking about, and how did he get that living hope? And it had to do with his begettal by God. God had begotten him as a son, brought him into his church, and to his work, and was going to use him to do one of the greatest works on this earth. Now, God is calling us into his family if we will allow that. He wants us to be sons. He wants us to be part of his family. But it's harder today than it will be in the millennium, the 1,000-year period, because, well, this is a very turbulent world in many, many ways, a violent world. But if we deeply understand what this begettal is all about, what it means if God calls us into his family now, but we still are not born into his family, we're just begotten. We have to be born into that family, and that takes some fighting in this spiritual war. We have to fight to achieve that and to build that hope. This is something the world simply cannot understand because they won't yield themselves to God for the most part. So it's all about being begotten in the family of God, and then you have to see the birth, what it means to be born into the very family of God for all eternity. Now, we see problems all around us, and it was prophesied that it would be this way. And how do we have minds that are just filled with hope in spite of all these problems all around us? And I'm telling you, there are many religious people that don't understand this. Notice what Lang's commentary says. Lang's commentary says, no portion of the New Testament is so thoroughly interwoven with quotations from allusions to the Old Testament. It contains in 105 verses, 23 quotations, while the epistle to the Ephesians has only 7, and that to the Galatians only 13. So Peter knew the Bible. He knew the Bible, and that's one of the main reasons that I'm sure that God put him in charge of the church. He knew the Bible so well, the Old Testament and the New Testament. He understood that. In verse 5 it says, 1 Peter 1 and verse 5, who are kept or guarded by the power of God through faith. It takes power to cling to this hope. It takes the power of God. Then the verse concludes, unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In the last time. Well, that's the time we're living in today. Let me give you a quote here. Lang's commentary says about the phrase, Peter thought immediately impending was that last time, which is actually the time in which we now live. It's for us today, specifically for this people in the last era of God's church, just prior to Jesus Christ's return. Thayer's lexicon says of this phrase, extreme, last in time or in place, talking about the last time, the trumpet after which no other will sound of the time nearest the return of Christ from heaven. See, it's about the second coming of Jesus Christ. And all of that is explained in my booklet on A Living Hope about Peter's epistles. So, notice what it continues to say here from the booklet. The word time is from the Greek word kairos. It reads this way, the definition is this way, season, time, but not merely as a succession of moments, which is chronos, 5550 in Strong's. Kairos implies that which time gives an opportunity to do, or opportune time, opportunity. This last hour presents us with an unparalleled opportunity. That's what Peter saw. It's an unparalleled opportunity. There's no other opportunity ever in all eternity like this one today. The first fruits being called out before the second coming of Jesus Christ. They have the greatest reward of all if they're loyal to God, if they have the hope of Peter in them. That's the way it is. The very elect today are going to be the very bride of Jesus Christ in Jerusalem for all eternity. They are going to sit on David's throne with Jesus Christ for all eternity. They're going to have that first fruits reward because it is more difficult today because Satan is here and he's full of wrath because he knows his time is short. That's why you see all these problems around the world. They're frightening unless you know where God is at this time. And he's right there in the middle of his own little very elect. That's what your Bible tells you in Revelation 1. But there's no other people that are called or begotten into such an opportunity. It's the greatest opportunity there ever will be for anybody from all men who have ever lived. God says, if you'll do my work and proclaim this message today, as Paul says, you'll be in a better resurrection. You'll be in a better resurrection. You'll have the Spirit of God working in your mind. Peter had a vision that was literally out of this world. Now, I'm not exaggerating, and I'll show you that. You need to see that. He had this vision when he was personally with Jesus Christ. Peter, James, and John went up in the high mountain with Christ. And Christ showed them a vision that made them fall over on their faces with fear. And yet, it was the most inspiring vision that has ever been shown to men on this earth. That is a fact. Peter was one of the three men that got to see it. Now, he wrote about this in his epistles because it was so monumental and it had such an impact on his mind. I want to go back and show you what this prophecy is all about, that he also talks about in his epistles. But it's also talked about in the Gospels, the first three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So let's take a look at that. In Matthew 16 and verse 28, it says this, "Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in His kingdom." Matthew 16 and verse 28. Now, a few days later, six days later, he fulfilled this promise, and Jesus took Peter, James, and John to this high mountain, and here's what he said and what happened. "And was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light." God says he's going to make those first fruits have that same shine, that same powerful face like the sun in his strength. And the raiment is going to be as white as the light. And you can prove all that to yourself. Now, he goes on to say in verse 5, or the prophecy does, "While he yet spoke, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them." A bright cloud. Everything is bright and brilliant. "And behold, a voice out of the cloud, which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear you him." Hear him. This is my Son. This is the Father talking about His Son, and He's creating more sons. He's creating Himself in sons. Many scriptures tell you that, and we will prove that to you if you haven't already proven it to yourself. Then it goes on to talk about Matthew 17, 10 and 11, where it says this is all tied into an end time Elijah. And here's what it says, "And his disciples asked him, saying, Why then say the scribes that Elijah shall first come?" That is, before Christ returns. "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Elijah shall truly first come and restore all things." That is, in the church. Restore all things. Now, this Elijah restored all things, and that was a sign of a time shortly before the coming of Jesus Christ and that vision that they were shown on a high mountain. But it was just a vision, and it caused them to fall over and on their faces afraid of it. But, of course, Christ showed them it was something to be joyful about. It was about His second coming. So, who was that end time Elijah that has already come and gone? So we're getting very close to the second coming of Jesus Christ, because the coming of that Elijah restoring all things is a sign that Christ's coming is imminent. It's very close. That's what it's all about. All things are restored just before Christ returns within the church. And then when Christ returns, all things are restored in the entire earth. Only the church sees that today, God's true church. So Peter wrote about this in this end time. And he was there, he saw it, and it had a real impact on him. Something he saw for the rest of his life very vividly, and especially just before he was martyred. And he was filled with hope. How do you explain all that? And then Matthew 17, verses 10 and 11 is really the most pivotal prophecy in all the New Testament, and perhaps all the Bible, when you think about it. So we have a sign there about what God is doing, and everything really revolves around this end time prophecy of Matthew 17, and especially Elijah restoring all things, and of course pointing to that second coming of Jesus Christ all the time. That's a real vision. Now, you wouldn't know what it looks like unless you were there. And then verses 17 and 18, it says, "For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, 'This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased.' And the voice came from the heaven we heard when we were with him in the Holy Mount." That's exactly what Peter saw explained there in Matthew 17. And he said, "I want you to understand this. I was there. Matthew, Mark, and Luke weren't there. I was there. And I want you to understand this vision. It is just mind-shattering in many ways, in a wonderful way, though. Peter is trying to draw us a picture of this, and he says, if you have this in your mind, you're going to have a living hope, a living hope. And then he goes on to say, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy," verse 19, "whereunto you do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts." Now that's about that second coming that he saw in a vision. And he's making this very personal. And that he's talking about what happened upon that mountaintop. But where it says, "Take heed as unto a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawn," that's the wonderful world tomorrow. But then it goes on to talk, "and the day star rises in your heart." What is that all about? Well, he says, I'll just read a little. This is written in our booklet. Revelation 22 and verse 16 calls Christ the bright and the morning star. That's the star that's more brighter than any other star. And he's likening these people that have this hope that Peter had to that star. It's a brighter star. It's a better resurrection for all eternity. You'll rule with Christ and the Father and rule the whole earth and then the universe forever under the Father and Christ, of course. But that's what this is talking about. This occurs after the day dawns, that is the last expression there, and Christ will return, he will meet his saints in the air, and then the day star will rise in their hearts. Christ in us will rise in our hearts, and in the sudden change we will be sons of God who look like Christ, and we will be the bride of Christ. The bride of Christ has to be a God being. And then verse 19 says, "I will give to him the morning star that he may be irradiated with its splendor and outshine all others like the morning star." Can you imagine that? It's like the morning star. It outshines all the others. That's the hope Peter saw. And martyrdom didn't even faze him at all, it seems. Of course, he had to be prepared for that. But what an amazing glory that is that God has given us. And that day star arises in our hearts when we become members of the God family. But think about this. If you look at Matthew, Mark, Luke, all have their version of this event. You can find that. Matthew 16, verse 28, and Matthew 17, verses 1 through 13 is the first one. Luke 9, verses 27 and 36 is another one. Mark 9 verses 1 through 13 is another one. But you see, Peter knew that Matthew, Mark, and Luke were not there. And he wanted them to see what he saw. He draws this picture for us. He was there and he saw that vision and he was moved and stirred by it and fell over on his face in fear. It was so amazing. A wonderful vision, but still frightening if you've never seen it before and don't understand it. What a memory he had in his mind. That vision just really, really moved him mightily, and he was facing problems coming up in 70 AD. It was getting very bad. That's only a type of what's coming in this end time if we don't heed God's message. God wants to save us from all of this terrible tribulation. in this world. It's already here in some ways. It's already here. Well, you can see how this hope is really a part of Peter's life, and Peter wants each one of us to just etch that vision into our minds. And he goes on to talk about the great trials they're going to have at that time in the future. And he says, now there's no prophecy of the Scripture of any private interpretation, but people try to interpret the Bible. They can't do that. Only God can interpret the Bible. We have to wait for Him to do that. You have to see that when you do get new revelation from God, and He does give it to His leaders, prophets and apostles, He does. That's what Ephesians 3 and verse 5 says, and only to those two offices. And that is something we need to know, because it is, God does work through men and until Jesus Christ returns. But He only uses them if they submit themselves to Him totally and completely. See, this is where people destroy their hope. They try to interpret the Bible themselves, and they can't do that. It interprets itself with God's information and His revelation. Well, Peter also talked about the trial of faith is more precious than gold. That fiery trial you have, it's more precious than gold. And then he goes on in 2 Peter 2 and talks about scathing trials and tests that are going to come upon them. Notice what he said, but there were false prophets and among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily, secretly, or surreptitiously shall bring in damnable or destructive heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. See, they were denying God. They were turning away from God, God's own people, and they had to be severely corrected. But let's go back and read this great prophecy of Matthew 17 one more time. Matthew 16, verse 28 says, the Son of Man coming in His kingdom. You'll see that, but of course it's a vision. And then verses 2 and 3 it says, and He was transfigured before them, and His face did shine as the sun, and His raiment was white as light. And His face just radiated this brilliance of the sun in its full strength. Now this is what Peter saw, and His own glory and excellence. It says, God's own glory and excellence. Peter saw all that. And then he heard that voice coming out of a bright cloud. This is my beloved Son. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear you Him. Will we hear Christ? Will we hear His message? Hear Him, these scriptures tell us. He wants us to hear this message and have the very hope that Peter had in his mind just before he was put to death by people to whom he was delivering this hope, if you can believe that. That's what it's all about. But I'll tell you, God's people are being trained today to regenerate this whole world. Something is terribly wrong with this world. God wants us to be prepared to rule with Christ when He gets here and help Him regenerate all mankind. And then there will be a resurrection at the end of that millennium, and all men who have ever lived will be able to be resurrected and get to know God and get to be filled with this hope that Peter was talking about. That's the world that's going to be here forever, and we'll never have a world like this again. We'll have a world full of hope and joy and peace, just like Peter had. Now that's what God wants us to have. That's what we were created to do and to be. Thank God for this hope in a hopeless world. Until next week, this is Gerald Flurry. Goodbye, friends.
Request the Epistles of Peter, A Living Hope, to learn how to build this kind of lasting hope in your mind. Also, request two lessons of the Herbert W. Armstrong College Bible Correspondence Course. All our materials are available free of charge, at no cost or obligation to you. Order now. The preceding program was a paid presentation of The Key of David, brought to you by the Philadelphia Church of God.